Only the heat wave. so I hear black sand burns like coal. Choose between your body and your soul. Raindrops sizzling pop dusty room. It's 40 below in Wisconsin. Sure enough, 40 below. And they said, the government in Madison announced that Wisconsin's closed. I thought, can they do that? Can you just close a state? I didn't know that was even an option, you know? I've heard of closing Disneyland, but closing Wisconsin seems a bit obsessive to me, you know? I was like, gee. You know, I'm already on the way to a gig, you know, it's snowing like crazy. The road, I was on Highway 12, it was so covered with snow, you couldn't see the road. But But fortunately, you can still see the tips of the fences. And so I simply kept equidistant from the fence on the right and the fence on the left, stayed in the center, went right to Fort Atkinson Cultural Hub of Wisconsin. 16 people showed up for the game, which I thought was miraculous given that the state was closed, you know? And plus, I sold them 11 CDs, so... So I'm talking about the cold. I happen to mention that my nipples have been hard since I landed in Ohio.
Show.
And then I did the... later. And somebody yells out, yeah, man, you're from California. They have earthquakes there. And I said, yes, it's true. We do have earthquakes. However, they don't last from October to May. They are brief and to the point. You simply change your soiled drawers and go on about your business. A minute or two of scaring the shit out of you and you're just back to normal. You know? Nothing like October to May kind of a winter. And here's the really important point about Californians and earthquakes. See, if we knew when they were coming, we'd leave. These people stay there all winter, you know what I'm saying? Hey, Martha, it's getting cold again, can you believe? You're right, Si, I think it happened just like this last year, didn't it? Yeah, the year before too, I think, no? And here it comes again, damn. You know, I think if you can see your breath, God is telling you, I'm coming for you. I'm going to get you, you know? That's your life breath leaking out. I mean, just... I just have never lived where the weather could kill me. I like weather that you don't notice is there. That's why I live in Southern California, where weather's not even allowed. You know? Although, if it rains if it rains, people go nuts. First of all, they can't believe that water is coming from the sky for free. Secondly, they're smashing into each other at an alarming rate on the freeways. It's like, you know, I mean, it's unbelievable. 101, 405, these freeways become long, skinny parking lots, you know? Just because it's raining. I'm sitting there in one of these jams, and I thought, Jesus, God. Any place else, this would be raining. Here, it's a disaster, you know? And then I thought, that's kind of an interesting idea. And then I wrote this song called Fair Weather Town. Fair Weather Town. I was sort of stymied about how to end the song. I had a verse about the weather, of course. And then on a twist, I like to twist songs a little bit. There was a verse about the show business and, you know, your checks in the mail kind of mentality of the Los Angeles show business. But I didn't know how to end the song. Then there were a series of murder trials in Los Angeles that the Menendez brothers chased their mom down the hall with a shotgun. But hey, they're just misunderstood boys, you know what I'm saying? You know, OJ gets off even though DNA is like May. I mean, people have been getting out of prison for 20 years because of DNA, but for some reason this DNA didn't work, you know, so I got to thinking that maybe I could write the third verse after all. So this is called Fairweather Town. Fair weather town. Chinese say that if you live long enough, everything will happen to you. It's a pretty suck reason for sticking around. And I realized that they actually meant something different than I had interpreted. Because if you live long enough, then you become the hated, the hater, the betrayed, and the betrayer. Empathize with each other and realize that forgiveness is all we can do. And I think that whatever life throws at you, it's how you handle it that makes up the quality of your lives. This is a song that was inspired by a woman in Baltimore that I thought did a miraculous thing in view of called Daddy's Eyes. Lucky to be alive, said a stranger all the night. You'd be surprised how many times this happened in the night. But the real surprise was waiting for me 9 months down that road. They brought you in for me to see. I felt my future fold. Straight up at me, you had your daddy's eyes. You got your daddy's eyes, I'm not likely to forget. And every time you look at me, that night comes back in the air. I cannot help but love you, can't help but be surprised. Brought you here, you got your daddy's eyes. Well, days have turned the weeks to years, this pain time will not heal. Sometimes when you look at me, I know I can't conceal the memory of that brutal night. Now I never try. What matters is the love we share. Got your daddy's eyes. You got your daddy's eyes. I'm not likely to forget. And every time you look at me, that night comes back. Cannot help but love you, can't help but be surprised. All the pain that brought you here, you got your daddy's eyes. The Lord works in mysterious ways, no man can understand. You must have faith in the seeds that grow from the fruit. There is a plan, there is a God, there is a reason too. For every life, every pain, every one of you. One day what we're doing here, we'll sift for truth through life. Look carefully and you will find. water with no ice, just something because my little throat is parched. some kind of water would be a nice gesture. You probably noticed by now that I'm a solo performer. I am, I swear. Sometimes that sucks, but sometimes it's great fun, you know, and I get invited into a lot of homes, a thing that I believe would not happen where I had like a 17-piece funk horn band. You know? One little white boy acoustic guitar, people feel safe, you know, so I get a lot of free dinners, and I get to meet a lot of families, and I get invited to a lot of parties. I was invited to a party thrown by some flight attendants in Chicago. I like flight attendants.
Lovely Chloe on water.
Anyhow, I do like flight attendants. They're clean, punctual people, and I think that's important these days, you know? And so I went to the party. It turns out that I was the only person at the party not employed by the airlines. And as you're probably also aware, whenever people work together in some sort of an insulated fashion, a vernacular evolves, you know, within the confines of the work environment. And this is certainly true of the airlines. And if you were given to a somewhat immature, sophomoric, sexual, stupid sense of humor, such as I am, you could have a pretty good time there just listening to them talk and imagining that there's, you know, sexual innuendo in there. It's kind of like that game in high school, Between the Sheets, where you just pick a song title and then you say Between the Sheets. Call that. It's the same sort of thing, you know. So I'm standing around in the corner listening while these gorgeous women are talking about like a layover in Detroit, you know. Layover, you bet, you know. And a turnaround in New York, which I thought was sort of intriguing. And I think it was when they got to deadheading that I felt perhaps I was out of my league. So I retired to a corner where I proceeded to drink, I don't know, 55, 60 beers. And I realized I was actually sloshing whenever someone stepped on me, you know? So I crawled off to find the bathroom. Now, I don't know what the bathroom looks like in your homes, but I am a musician. I have somewhat of a responsibility to have a funky bathroom, and I believe that I have succeeded beyond your wildest expectations. My bathroom, well, there's something growing on the shower curtain I cannot kill. Will not die. It's blue-green in the summer. It actually gets black and has a bouquet you can discern when you pull in the driveway. You know, it's a perfect pet for a musician because it thrives no matter how long I'm gone. It's my little guy there, you know? And I have a pile of towels that went down in the corner wet and have actually evolved into a lower life form themselves. Sometimes in your peripheral vision, you can see them undulate, you know, but when you look at them, they're still. When you're looking away, they start wiggling. It's bizarre. And I have a sink, of course. There's an orange teardrop in the sink where hundreds of plumbers have failed to stop this dripping thing. And I have a bar of soap stuck to the sink, you know, little curly hairs in the soap. You know, we're talking down-home bathroom, folks. You go into my bathroom, be as disgusting as you want. Feel okay about yourself. Well, the bathroom in this flight attendant's condo was a shrine. Clear plastic shower curtain, not a water spot on it. Chandelier in the bathroom, a chandelier. Mirrors on the walls and ceiling so you could watch yourself in a variety of angles while you did it. Designer towels that came from God to the wall, accompanied by a sign that said, please don't use the designer towels. Simulated marble sink, brass pedestal. In the brass pedestal, a bar of soap that had never, ever been wet. What happens in this bathroom? Where do they go? Now to a neighbor? I mean, what's this for, you know? And my bathroom, I have tile in it so you can hose it out when it gets really grim, you know? But But she had a blue shag rug all over the floor of the bathroom, and then, I suppose by way of continuing the integrity of design, she brought the blue shag rug up around the bowl of the toilet, over the tank of the toilet, over the top of the tank of the toilet, over the lid of the toilet, around the seat of the toilet, looked like a Muppet toilet. Sit down, James. I'm not sitting on the Cookie Monster's face. Again, know what I mean? And while we're on the subject of toilets, something else I feel I should share this with you, because I think this is important. I don't believe that many women ponder the way men do it, so I'm going to share this with you. This is a dinner house. I promise to be tasteful. But here's the way it works. We approach the facility from an erect position. This is one that we maintain throughout the act. We're talking number one. We are talking number one, lest you be confused. Number one, okay. We raise the lid, put it back against the tank, and then, provided we're well-bred, we raise the seat, put that back against the lid, the tank, and then we commence. Now, this works with supreme efficiency in my bathroom. But when you ladies go to the trouble of upholstering your tank, you told me, ladies, then the lid and the seat stay up there to maybe 3 seconds. Just until we men are irrevocably involved in what we're doing. And then, thwop! This thing comes snapping down at you. Ah! You leap out of the way. It's a completely involuntary survival instinct, you know what I mean? Cookie Monster lunges for your loins. Run away! Just run away. You don't think about it. Run away! You just run away. Now, who can be accurate when you're sprinting across the room? So, while I was using her Maxi 500 to blow dry the lid and the seat there, and the tank and the top of the tank, and designer towels and the mirrors and the shower curtain, the chandelier, the rug, simulated marble sink, the brass pedestal, and the bar of soap, finally gotten wet. I've got an idea for a love song.
Just like now.
very much. It's called Just Like Love. A couple of years ago, I was at a party in Hollywood. Met the director of Deep Space Nine, Star Trek Deep Space Nine. I said, geez, wow, I'm crazed for those Star Trek things. I've seen all the episodes of the original Spock and Kirk. I saw all the TNG episodes. I watched the Deep Space Nine. I love it. Who do I have to kill to get on that show? Except I didn't say kill. So I came to an arrangement, and the very next day, I got a call from Paramount. They said, James, when can you come in for a fitting? As it happened, I had the rest of my life off, so far as I knew. So I raced right down there, because things too cooled in Hollywood rather quickly. And so I raced right down there, you know, and they fitted me out with a security guard uniform. I mean, for Deep Space Nine. The bitch tricked me bad! No, she... It was on the TV show. I actually got to dress up like a Bajoran security guard and work for Rene Auberjonois, who plays Odo, the shape-shifting head of security. I was one of Odo's thugs. And I had a grand time, and they said, James, you have a gift for standing around and looking inobtrusive. Perhaps you'd like to do the rest of the season. And I said, I would. And I've now done 4 seasons for them, and I'm telling you, I'm having the time of my life. I get to dress up like all these goofy monsters and walk around, and they give me money. It's so cool. Usually I just dress as a Bajoran, you know, I wear this rubber thing right on my nose, just like the back of a sneaker, you know? And it's really easy makeup, and the pay is not bad. But sometimes I get to be, I was a Cardassian a couple weeks ago, and I've been a Romulan. I've been a Romulan twice, actually, and I've been Vulcan, like Spock. And for the premiere episode of this season, I was the singing Klingon. It was great fun, you know. Although we have to go to makeup for Klingons, you go for makeup at 2 a.m. and sit in the chair for 4 hours while they glue all this stuff all over you, and then you look like a big, mean guy, you know. To tell you the truth, you are a big, mean guy when they're done with you. It's so uncomfortable and hot that you're just an irritable prick by the time you get to the stage, which is the way you're supposed to be for the part. So it's perfect, you know. We were on the home planet, and I got to sing this song as we drank blood wine. Really, I don't think Mandabi's going to catch on. And they're the Klingon home planet drinking blood wine. You got to drink it quick, of course, because that's right. Anyway, I'm loving it. I'm having a grand time. There's really nothing, no downside to it, with one small exception. It seems that Gene Roddenberry, the man who created Star Trek, felt that there should be, how can I put this, there should be no unsightly bulges in space. So he devised this underwear for the men to wear. It's like a girdle from the 50s, you know, but it's for guys. And you put this thing on, and it's unbelievably tiny, you know? And then you're all thrust into this thing. It goes from like your mid-thigh to your mid-waist, and it's so tight, it just kind of mashes you up against yourself there, so you look kind of like a Ken doll, you know what I mean? You're all mashed and tight and just smooth as can be, you know? And that's the way. Conversely, the women are given push-up bras. It's weird, isn't it? And in any event, we have to wear these underwear all day, so that gets pretty uncomfortable. But mostly if you have to go to the bathroom, because for a variety of reasons, it's no damn fun, you know? First of all, men's underwear has a flap in the front that opens vertically so that you can actually go to the bathroom without taking off your clothes. We're talking number one. But the underwear that Gene Roddenberry invented, the Roddenberry underwear, has a horizontal flap, and it's made out of very, very tough elastic. So first of all, you reach down and you gotta pull this one apart, this one. Then you reach in with these two fingers and you grab the other underwear and you pull it that way. And then you reach in and try to find yourself, you know what I mean? And then when you do find yourself, you can't believe it, you know? That's not me, that's not me, that's not the Python of love, you know? That can't be me, that little mashed mangling thing is not me. It's miserable. That's the only down. That's the other than that, it's great. You know what? I don't think that Kirk ever wore that. Because he always got the girl. You know what I mean? clearly he had the only unsightly balls in space, but everybody else was all trussed up, you know? That's the secret of his popularity. Anyhow, I was going to write a song about it, but I never did. So this song is sort of about space. It's called Racing the Moon. appreciate that. I do want to mention, for those of you who didn't know it, that I have no day job outside of 2 days in space. And that I make CDs. I know that sometimes, well, actually there's millions of people around America that don't have them, perhaps some of you. I don't know. So what I have done is actually assume the humbling posture of schlepping our CDs around myself. Now believe me, folks, there is a degree of humility involved in schlepping your own CDs into a lovely place like the town crier. But it's nothing compared to the profound sense of humility we experience here at the end of the same evening. We're forced to schlep those same CDs back out to the car. So, on the break, we will be yelling over here, meet the artist, and thrill of a lifetime, and shamelessly pandering. So, come and say hello. In the meantime, weeks ago now, well, months, okay, 34 years ago, I was working with a fake ID in this little bar in Santa Cruz. A band came through, actually a group of singers came through, and the musician who accompanied them, because they didn't play any instruments, they just sang their buns off. The musician, a fine musician, and a very funny, charming fellow, he and I hit it off, and have remained friends straight through till now, and so I'd like you to join me in welcoming my dearest friend on the planet, a man who has never let me down, Mr. Peter Torres.
Leave me behind, yeah.
I love you, baby, baby.
that song and this next coming they share the enviable situation of appearing both on my solo album, my own solo CD, Stranger Things Have Happened, which did James, thank you very much. Did James tell you that we were selling that? We're selling the living shit out of it. We possibly can. I mean, you know, as a matter of fact, we have you guys trapped because unless you pay something, you have to buy something, you have to pay something to get out of here. So anyway, that's the last song in this coming song up here on Stranger Things in Hackman. God, the mouth didn't work yesterday, and the same thing is happening today. I haven't had it in for a 50,000 mile checkup. The songs also appeared on records put out by that group to which I used to belong. And, also, the cast of that television show that I used to be in. This next song appeared on the first single, the B-side of the first single put out. And this is not the arrangement that was on the record, but it's pretty much the song. There's a third arrangement, which I can recommend, by Taj Mahal. This is the one, pretty much the one that appeared on my album, Carole King song called...
Take a Giant Step.
You're one of those guys who hires a plumber and then tells him which tools to use.
Inside was turned to heart to frost. I will mend your heart again. Remember the feeling as a child when you wake up in morning smile. This time you felt like you did then. Come with me, I'll take you where the taste of life is green, and every day holds wonders to be seen. Come with me, maybe yesterday the heart. Step outside your window. You stare at me in disbelief. You say for you there's no relief, but I swear I'll prove you wrong. Don't sit here in your lonely room, just staring back in silent gloom. That's not where you belong. There is no percentage in remembering the past. It's time you learn to live again at last. Come with me, yesterday behind, and take a giant step outside your mind. There is no percentage in remembering the past. It's time you learn to live again. Outside your mind. Come with me, leave yesterday behind. Take a giant step outside your mind. Outside your mind. Well, outside your mind.
Thank you shows. We let you come in here with video cameras. The no-no is flashes. No flashes. You have to go straight to the principal's. Vice principal's office.
The vice principal.
No, not the vice principal.
He's the man in charge of
vice. You guys hire plumbers and sneer at them. Okay, I'm going to do a song put out by the greatest rock and roll group of all time.
A lady, Madonna, children at your feet, wonder how you managed to make ends meet. Who finds the was heaven sent. Friday night arrived with a suitcase. Sunday morning we met like a nun. Monday's child has learned to tie his bootleg. See how they run. Lady Madonna, baby at your breast, wonders how you manage to feed the bed.
This next section, right? And not so tough, sing it. I'm gonna have to remember this.
See how they run. Lady Madonna, lying on your bed. Listen to the music playing in your head.
Sing your part.
Tuesday afternoon is never an end. Wednesday morning papers didn't come. Thursday night your stockings needed mending. See how they run. Lady Madonna, lying on your bed. Listen to the music playing in your head.
In keeping with the holiday season, and remember that there's only 108 or so shopping days left till Christmas, or for those of you who haven't taken down your Christmas trees yet, I'm going to sing a Christmas song. Thank you. I'll tell him when I see him. Actually, the real reason I'm going to sing this Christmas song is I'll be damned if I'm going to come around here sometime between December. Like November 25th, just to sing this one song for you folks. So you take it with you, you know. Remember it until Christmas. And, you know, then you think, God, Peter was here today and he sang the song, and it's so appropriate now.
I remember Christmas in 62. Danny put the blindfold on and broke that old piñata right in two. The toys came tumbling down, and still she felt so blue and didn't know why. And I remember Christmas in 64. Chrissy woke up in the dark on Christmas morning, opened up the door, saw the Lincoln Logs just like the year before, and started to cry. And I remember Christmas in 69, wanted to get home, but the boys in the band said we don't have the time. There's so much work to do. We take what we can and find no comfort and joy. I would make a wish, but then who am I? I would take the yearning, any kind of burning hopes that never die. These I would not destroy. Yes, these I would satisfy. And why can't this Christmas find at least some peace of mind, some sweet release, at least for each and every girl and boy? a brother. Soon we sailed together for that foreign shore. The cities were in ruins, and still I dream of war. Yes, even today. I remember Christmas in 81. Tried to explain the war in places near and foreign to my only son, who could not understand, whose life had just begun, and all I could say is someday we'll believe we're worth some peace of mind, some peace on earth. Goodwill to all in each and every day, some fine Christmas day, some fine Christmas day, some fine Christmas day.
Into urban music and gave it the all of the extra oomph that it had. You guys have a part. You'll remember this song and you'll know your part. But just in case you don't, I'm going to have somebody run amongst you and you know, yell the lyrics in your ears.
Well, your love, you slipped from me higher than I've ever been lifted before. Keep it up, which is my desire, and I'll be at your side. Forevermore, because your love, you slipped from me.
It's all that moves. Left in me, huh?
I was
saying, no requests, right? But because I did have one more thing I wanted to say about that, and that is that if you know my set list and you know the songs I'm going to do, and you want to ask for one out of order, in order to feel that you have some control over your lives, tough dart. Okay, now, a fellow named Riley Cummings, whose nom du 60s was Riley Wildflower, wrote this song about me. It's called Good Looker. I am not, regrettably, in the title role. However good looking you may think I am, or not, it's not me. The good looker in the title is a woman who mercifully is no longer in my life. I mean, I wish her no ill will. In fact, I may even fairly say I love her. I mean, I love everybody. Some of you at a distance. Some of you are hazardous to my health. And so I take great pains in choosing among those people whom I wish to love approximately. Not approximately, okay, you get me. Oh, I'm in the Northeast, I'm safe, I can say those. The weird thing about the song, however, is that he wrote the song before the events depicted therein came to pass. It's called Good Looker by Riley Wildflower. It goes something like this. Charts in 13 cities. She was a real good looker, but she never looked my way. Yeah. She sat on the stage everywhere we went while we played the boogie boogie. She had a heart of gold, but I'm not allowed to say. You know, she told me that she loved me. Well, I thought it over and I told her that I felt the same. Yeah. We bought a house with a fenced-in yard in the north side of the canyon. And we spent that winter listening to the rain. The summer's here and our sails went down. And all the easy days was over. They took my house and my big black car away. Yeah. Back on the road, we took the band, we gotta go do the whole thing over. And my good looker was looking the other way. It's I call it that just because it's the only part of the lyric that I could, you know, that I thought made any connection whatsoever to. Why am I talking here? was some oldies station promised an extravaganza of special oldies and stuff, and I turned on the tape recorder and left the house and came back and played the tape much later, like months. And there was this one tune on it that was really, I thought, I don't know what you guys are going to, what the heck. It's Clyde McFadder, who I think sang from the Drifters, was originally with the Drifters. It's Clyde McFadder. Clyde McFadder tune. Don't hold it. It's a tuning tune.
Thank you.
Well, let's see what the machine says. Get its A, E. Hello. There we go. No. Okay, close enough. Now. Well, not good, but close enough, you know. I figure if I touch you with it and mess with it, it's going to get worse. Okay, here's another song from that.
Take 10 minutes, we'll be back. We're trying to sell you all we can.